going to share my screen. I've been listening to people's presentations and updating my content during the morning. Let me just go to my share screen. There we go. And right, this one here. And let's go. Okay, and you can now see my screen, correct?
Yes.
You can see my slideshow?
Yes.
Okay. Right, thank you very much. And I'll just move that onto the screen, Russ. I'm looking at you as well as looking at that. Okay. Can you still see it? It says it's paused now. Is it paused or not? Hello? Can anybody tell me? Can you still see my screen or does it say it's paused?
I see the screen.
Did it just change?
I see the first page. Yeah.
The title page, making it easy.
Yeah.
Oh, okay, hang on a second. I just moved it over so I could look at it while I'm talking to you. But it's okay, now let's see if we got here desktop. Okay. Resume share. Okay, here we go. All right, resume share. Cannot believe this. Hang on a second. I'm going to move it back to the other screen. Okay, I'm going to try one more time here. Okay, I think you got it now. Let me see if that's going to change. Yes, it's going to change. Excellent. I'll just move my camera over here so I can look at you. Right. Okay, why that's important is because I am dyslexic. I get very easily disorientated by things. And I also have a lot of dyslexic students. And camera pointed down too low. Okay, looking at making it easy to meet expectations, I've had a lot of classroom experience, and what I noticed was there are always students who don't participate. And I talk about this a lot. And when I went into the university sector, it was at the beginning of, it was year two of the pandemic. So it was a new environment for me to be working with students in the university classroom and with a lot of students who were going to be perhaps online, or they returned to the classroom. And I'd been interested in why it was hard for some people to do tasks. So I looked at this issue here, that the students who drop out or they do minimum attendance. And I was thinking, why is this happening? What's going on here? Because you've got this classroom, typical classroom. A lot of my classrooms are about 35 kids. And people had said to me, oh, yeah, you'll get kids. They'll just turn up for five. You know, they'll count five classes. They won't turn up. They'll turn up for the minimum 10. And I noticed that that wasn't necessarily happening. And I wasn't sure why. And I think a lot of you have seen me struggle with passwords, struggle with logging in on time, et cetera, and often it's passwords. And so what I noticed was, is this going to change for me? Right. You do have these kids that suddenly disappear. And I had a couple that disappeared spectacularly. And I wondered what was going on. Why is this happening? So I started surveying the students, and it would be, in a lot of cases, it's their lack of history of success with technology. And I thought, okay, I'm going to bring more opportunities to give them more exposure to different things, give them model things to them. I usually log on to a device, exactly the same device the students are using when they are studying. So I have like my iPad on, and I also have my computer, but I switch between the two so that if I'm showing them something new, I will show it to them the same way as it appears on their device. And most of the time they're going to choose to access stuff via their devices. There needs to be practice time. There needs to be fun. And there needs to be understanding. And what I mean by that needing to be understanding is that not everybody has that success with technology. So this was a surprise to me that there was, during the pandemic, there was a study on difficulty with dyslexic accessing passwords and forgetting them. And I had realized that this had been something that happened to me all the time. At least once a month, I would have password issues. And one of the problems with password issues is you get this message saying, you're going to, you know, automatic password, you're going to allow somebody to use this password to save this in the system. Are you sure you want to do that? And for me, that sets off an immediate panic. Oh my God, do I actually want to do this? Is it always going to work every time? And I think, nah, I'm going to have a password and I'm going to remember it. I'm going to write it down. And I invariably write them down. I lose them. I don't have the book on me. I don't have something. And so very recently, the very patient Jose Domingo Cruz walked me slowly through the process that Adam Jenkins had been and Samantha Kawakami had been recommending to me and Jenny Crittenden of, you know, using systems for passwords. And that literally changed my life. It made a lot of difference to me. And I thought of the student that I had last year who came to my classes. He had some kind of a difference of learning and he came to my desk and he asked me, I can't get into this thing. I want to practice. I can't get into it. Can you reset my password? And so I did. And then I messaged him a bit later and said, oh, how's it going? And he said, oh, good. I said, I noticed you haven't done this. And he's like, yeah, I can't get in. And I said, okay, well, just go to the system, go to the system room and get them to log you in. But he wouldn't. Because going to the system room, the Johor Center, it's called, involves signing something and handing over a thing that says you forgot your password. Now, if you're a dyslexic or you've got maybe you've got autism or maybe you've got ADHD, you are going to be very, very resistant to the concept of putting yourself into a position where you're going to be shamed. So this is why I'm saying, be understanding. You have every single class, and increasingly so, is going to have a number of students who have working memory issues. So be understanding. Make it easy. Survey your students. Day one, experience on all software, the number of times they had used it, the percentage of comfort in using it. I specifically use some humor in that sort of, some of them I put in a life raft symbol as like in my surveys, I've gone from being very text-based to actually using icons more. And one of them is the life raft and help me. And students, if they know that's an option, they will use it. And they will tell you if they're having difficulty using it. And the fact that you ask, if I ask that, okay, I'm 100% okay, I'm 50% okay, I'm so-so, help, that means that I'm expecting there to be some help questions. And so students have used them and they have contacted me more. Share the results. This is a nice little function which is in Teams, and I can ask a single question on something. We did it in the class. We were talking about locations, complex locations, like it's in Asia, it's in North Asia, in a country, in this point, being able to mine through location information precisely. And so these, you can do anonymous surveys, and well, you can make, they're anonymous in to the rest of the world, but like I can see who they are. But I would do these surveys and I could see the ones who are green are sort of happy, but like the more worried they are, they go to more towards red or orange. In Teams, if you have this, it's in the assignments in the insights menu or reflect menu, I think this one is. But you don't want to overdo it because people do wear out with survey information. And particularly if you use the same questions, people just go, yeah, whatever. Watch the trends. So do the trends change? In fact, I've then copied and pasted the same thing in, but you can watch trends over time. And I also show that to students, you can see the trends. And so I showed them the results and they're really interested to see how's everybody going as a class? How are we doing with this? And what it's done is that I've whenever I introduce anything new, or after I've done one of these surveys, I say, okay, oh, look, there's a few people who are not comfortable with this. Let's have a chat together about it. You know, just talk to the person next to you. Can you do this? Can you do that? And basically I say, okay, we're going to do this until everybody knows how to use that. And so who's, okay, you've got it. Good. Okay. You are now teachers. Off you go. Stand up, and anybody else who needs help with this, go and talk to them. So I've established that in my classes every single time. When there's something new, we go through that process. And the attendance rate, although as Susan said, the attendance is like, it's an interesting issue because you do have some people who can't join in or won't, but they might be hovering online. The attendance rate went up. And so I think out of all of my students, I think I've only got, out of about 400, I think I have about 3 who have hit the 5 absences mark. But the rest of them are pretty much there. The majority of them have attended 14 or more classes. So it seems to be working to me, it seems to be working, that process. Advocate for the students. And I've been down to the Johor Centre, to the Information Centre in each of my 4 universities, and I've talked about that issue of passwords and about how, and I've told them about the student who dropped out of class rather than admit he could not remember his password. And that was a terrible shame that a student would drop out because of the fear of doing that. But if you have somebody with ADHD, they're likely to have a supplementary issue called rejection sensitivity dysphoria, which means they are really worried about failure. That's based on a history of being scolded constantly since childhood. And rejection sensitivity dysphoria is present in, they used to think it was about 80%, but they've now revised that up. Professor Russell Barclay has revised it to something like, William Dodson has revised it to maybe close to 100% of people with ADD are worried about making a mistake to the point of phobic. And that phobia will kill any chance of learning. I don't know how my time's going, and I can't see Jose at the moment. But bring the ICT into your classroom. And what I have done is I've actually now got the people in the ICT team at my university are actually, thank you, they've joined my classes as fake students. So I've now got those teachers, those people in the center have now joined the class, and they are attempting some of the tasks that I'm using. They're trying out doing, you know, responding to things and learning how, learning what it's like to be in my class, I suppose, or looking, and because I always report if I notice any anomalies in the system or whether it's not working, I actually do, I say, hey, this isn't working, and I screenshot it and document it. And so that, plus the fact that my unusually high attendance rate has been clocked by the school affairs office, I've now got people saying, well, what are you doing? And I think the number one thing that is important is that ask your students, what do you know, rather than assuming it's they're not doing something because of motivation. It's probably going to be because it's novel, and it's a novel, and they don't know how to do it, and they are too embarrassed to show someone. So my big change, small impact, big change is survey your students. Show them, go into their world, meet them where they are, as Susan said. Show them the stuff on their own screen. I think Sam also demonstrated that. Show them where you are. Be honest, which is what Chiku was talking about as well. But yeah, bring the ICT into your classroom and don't assume that they have perfect knowledge of things. And some people will have difficulties that you don't expect. So, for example, with Canva, Canva is really, really hard for me to use. I can use lots of systems, but I cannot use Canva, and I have no idea why that particular piece of software is difficult for me. So what might be easy for one person won't necessarily be easy for somebody else. And at that, I will stop it and I will throw open the floor to any questions. Okay, thank you. I think that's the end of my slides. Yeah, that's it.
Fabulous. First, round of applause, everyone. I didn't see a whole lot of questions, a lot of comments, though. Obviously, people are listening and are really bringing in your information, Alex. Does anyone have a question that they would like to open up their microphones to address to Alex? Otherwise, I have a point. Just on your point about showing, not telling, Alex, that's something that Todd reminded me about in a recent conversation. Oh, no, it wasn't Todd. It was Mike DeJong. Show, don't tell. One of the other good things about using Zoom in your classroom is that you can hit that record button at almost any time. And I was surprised when I did it myself, how difficult it is to actually send multiple photographs in Moodle to an assignment. And when I noticed that, I actually recorded, okay, this is what you have to do. Now, you don't push this button, you push this button, and this is how you rename the files. And recording that and then putting that on your Moodle in a video, show, don't tell, I think is a really good principle that helped me help my students a lot.
Thank you. If I can actually get this thing up, I would actually show you something, that a training moment I did this morning. I do a lot of sort of mini graphics of how to do something. But my I meant to leave the iPhone downstairs, but I do a lot of graphics which have like images and lines and how to change things, and that makes a massive difference for people in knowing how to do it. If you can give them a static model with arrows and to go here, go here, go here, it will make a really, really big difference to their lives, basically.
Sachiko came up with a question. Alex, would you like me to read it, or Sachiko, would you like to open up your— Sachiko, go ahead.
Yeah, so you mentioned you have your OTC team sit in as fake students. What exactly is that during regular class, and what exactly do the fake students do?
Those people are the ICT people, the Johor Center staff. Okay. And I've actually had them come into the classroom, and I've been in the same class, or the classroom nearby to where they work. And so when students couldn't log in or they weren't doing something, I go and have a look and I said, oh, how's it going? Oh, you can't log in. Okay, no problem. Right. And I just get on the phone to the Johor Center and I get them to come up and say, hey, look, we've got a problem here with this system. And could you help out? And they actually walk around the room helping people reset their stuff that they couldn't get into. So instead of them being scary, remote and scary, they came into the class and they got so interested in what I was doing that then they then approached me afterwards and said, oh, we know, we've noticed that some people can't do this, or we want to test this out, or we want to test that fault. And now they've become dummy students. So they try to do my assignments and see if they have the same problem that any of the students reported.
That's awesome. Thank you. That's a great idea.
And we just communicate through DeepL or Google Translate, because I don't have the technical language skills to explain the exact problems I have with the technology. So, so they're learning a lot also about technology, which will then be good for when they had to deal with students from other cultures. Alex, thank you.